It is summertime, and as you make your way through to the beach or cross to the river, you'll hear the drones of the humble cicada. There are more than 200 species living in Australia, and they're about as iconic as any summer insect can get. Nathan Emery has put together a photo guide to common cicadas of the Greater Sydney area and joins us on the line. How are you, Nathan?
Good, thanks, Simon. How are you?
Very well. Happy birthday, by the way.
Oh, thank you very much.
This is the week where all the best people are born, you see.
Yeah, absolutely.
Were you, as a kid, one of those people that would go out and try and find the elusive rare double drummer, the Union Jack, or any of the other different types of cicadas?
Well, actually, when I was a little boy, my dad would take me out to a lot of the national parks and nature reserves around Sydney, and we'd be armed with our little insect nets and trying to catch cicadas, because he had a an interest in it when he was a kid too, and so we'd be trying to catch any cicada we could to try and impress Dad.
And they have such great names. I'm thinking of the Flowery Baker, the Black Prince, the Green Grocer.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I think that's one of the unique things to cicadas too, and it's something that attracts people to them as well, just these really, really cool names, and they're very memorable.
I'm surprised to find out that there's more than 200 species.
Well, actually, we think there's possibly upwards of 750 and maybe even 1,000 if we could actually get out and survey some of the more central arid environments of Australia. And, you know, we really are the cicada capital of the world here in Australia, because, you know, we compare it to places like North America, which have about 170 species. South Africa has about 150. Even the UK only has one species, so we're really out in front.
And when you look around the world, do they all call them cicadas?
Yep, they're all called cicadas, and they've all got unique songs, every different species.
So, I bet, can you name this one? We don't even know the answer to that, so it's okay. When you look at it, there are a variety of not just species, but sizes as well. I'm thinking of, you know, the green grocer is your standard size, but I seem to remember on the south coast as a kid seeing ones that were only two centimetres long.
Yeah, and they can get even smaller than that, so down to even about 1 centimetre, some of the smallest cicadas that we've got here in Sydney and around Australia too.
So are there some that are more common than others? I remember I only ever in one summer got one, what we called a Union Jack, which was a double drummer.
Yep.
But, you know, there seem to be a plethora of green grocers.
Yeah, green grocers seem to have adapted to urban living, particularly in Sydney. There's the green grocer, Flowery Baker, and also the smaller Silver Princess cicada, which seem to, for some reason, be able to adapt very well, and that might have to do with some of our green spaces that we have here and the particular plant species that line our suburban streets. But they do sort of wax and wane between different seasons, and we're not quite sure why that is, but we're trying to uncover some of the factors that are causing that.
In fact, that you've just touched on something there, I wondered, because, you know, in some years it would be the elusive Black Prince, only to find out next year there were hundreds of Black Princes and not many Flowery Bakers, for example. Do we get different years having more or less of different cicadas?
Yeah, they wax and wane through different seasons, and that's just down to sort of, I guess, the broods and the number of years that they've got to spend underground before they finally emerge out as adults and sing, and then we see them or hear them. And I mean, we can go through a number of years where we just don't see or hear a particular species for some unknown reason, and it'd be really good if we can figure out why that actually is, because then we've got no idea whether or not we can call a species rare or common in one area if they don't come out one particular year, but then they do another.
It sounds as though it's something, with the exception of yourself, many people have taken for granted. Or is there a lot of research that's been done on the cicada?
Most of the research that's been done has been from a taxonomic point perspective, so a lot of describing the unknown species that we have here in Australia. I've started to work on a bit of the ecology and behaviour of cicadas too, trying to figure out what plant species they prefer to call on and feed off, as well as whether the vegetation community affects whether we hear and see different cicadas. So we're only just starting to, I guess, identify those initial factors, and hopefully in the next coming years we can find out more about our cicadas.
I remember being told as a kid that the life cycle was 7 years underground, 7 days above ground. Is that true, or is that just something my dad said to make him sound informed?
I think he's pretty spot on there. We think possibly 7 to 10 years.
Wow.
So if you can think back to 2013, we had a phenomenal year for cicadas. They were just everywhere, and I think a lot of people's hearing suffered because of it. And you sort of go back through the records, and we go back to about 2003 when the previous mass emergence, particularly of green grocers, occurred, and even back further, 1993 was another large year for these species.
So what do they do for that 7 to 10 years underground? Are they crawling through burrows, or are they pretty sedentary and just hanging there?
Yeah, they stay fairly close to the host plant's roots, so they feed off the roots, and they go through a number of molting stages as a nymph before they finally emerge and have that last molting stage and become adult cicadas.
So the nymph itself will start, I would imagine, very, very small and then grow.
Yeah, they can fit on the top of a pinhead. It's very, very small.
And they, as you said, shed that hard shell. Is the shell hard when they're underground?
No, it's quite soft, and then it'll harden up as they get larger and larger and progress towards their final molt.
Is that a common thing amongst insects? Because I know it occurs regularly in crustacea, but for insects, I didn't know that happened.
Yeah, it's quite common. It also occurs in butterflies is a great example. So the caterpillar forms a chrysalis and then emerges out as the butterfly, looking completely different, just like the adult cicada compared to its nymph stage. There's also dragonflies. And this time of year too, a lot of Christmas beetles, they start off as caterpillars too, underground in the soil.
But under the ground, when they shed that skin, that seems to be, one of those. Do we see all these little cicada skins underground if we were to dig them up?
No, it's very, very hard to find a cicada underground. We sort of have to look for branches where the females have laid eggs and bring that back and I guess wait for those eggs to drop into the soil and become nymphs. And the only way we can sort of keep a track on that is to have almost like a sort of an ant farm set up so you can see them in the soil.
They do sound tricky critters to get to know. So we've gone through the 7 years underground, then they for some reason take to the surface and transform.
Yes, they go through their final molt, they harden up their exoskeleton and pump up their wings and develop the colours that we see too as adult cicadas, and then they spend the next week or two, the males do anyway, looking for a female to mate with.
She will then lay eggs?
Yep, she can lay up to several hundred in some species on soft branches. They pierce the wood with a long ovipositor and lay their eggs in these little slits of wood that they lift up.
Ah, so those big little proboscis coming down that are folded under, I thought were for feeding, but that's for egg laying.
Yeah, the proboscis is for feeding. That's sort of underneath the, I guess, where we would consider the mouth or the nose to be, but the ovipositor is at the rear end of the female.
The eyes, those big bulging eyes, are there anything special about cicada eyes?
They've got very good vision. Certainly makes it hard for us out in the field to catch them, because they can always seem to detect where we are. Even if we try and camouflage ourselves as best as possible in the vegetation, they're always very flighty and seem to have excellent vision.
Joining us, Dr. Nathan Emery from the Australian Botanic Gardens and author of A Photo Guide to Common Cicadas of the Greater Sydney Region. You mentioned pump up the wings.
Yep.
They pump them up?
Yeah, they're very retracted and very small when they come out of the nymph shell, so they can fit inside that. So much like a butterfly sort of pumps up its wings when it emerges from the chrysalis, that's what the cicada does as well, and that can take up to a couple of hours to fully form.
Now, you mentioned that underground they feed off the roots of what will become the host tree. Once they actually come out and embrace summertime, are they still eating?
Yeah, they'll still feed. They need to feed. They'll suck the sugars out of the tree to get the energy to fly around and look for mates, and also to call out as well. So they need to keep feeding to be able to do that.
Now, I gather it's only the males that make that call.
Yeah, the males make the call. For the larger cicadas, like the greengrocer, the males tend to congregate together and call in unison, and that's why it's so loud when we hear them. And the females actually fly to the males as they're calling. For a lot of the smaller species, the males will sing and fly around and sing and look for females. And if a female cicada is actually interested in the male, she'll click her wings and sort of sounds like us clicking our fingers.
And how do they actually make that noise? I mean, as kids, we called it a drum.
Yeah, I still call it a drum too. They've got a couple of structures on their underside called timbals, which the males have a hollow abdomen as well, which they fill up with air and allows them to produce the noise through these timbals or drums.
And so that opens and shuts. What's the mechanics of that drum?
Yeah, it opens and shuts and also sort of produces, it's like a sort of a vibration that they use. I guess you can sort of almost think of it like a bit of a bagpipe too, with the sort of inflating of the abdomen and just allowing that timbal to vibrate up and down and create that sound.
Do we know how loud they can go? Because, I mean, let's face it, some summer times it's almost deafening.
Yeah, they can get up to well over 100 decibels, particularly the greengrocer and some of those larger species. They can get close to 120 decibels, which, you know, is in line with your jackhammers outside and your household blenders inside as well, so they can be very, very loud.
And do you have a favourite?
Oh, that's a hard question. My favourite growing up was always the red eye. I really just love that contrast between the black cicada and its dark red eyes.
Is that what I would have called the Black Prince in those days?
Possibly, but the Black Prince is a little bit different, and people always tell me that the Black Prince was a lot rarer when they were growing up and used to actually be worth a bit of money too.
Well, that is also the myth that used to go around when I was a kid, that you could take your Black Prince to a chemist and get money.
Yeah, that's what I've heard too, but it hasn't worked for me so far.
I can tell you, as somebody that did it in that era and saw the absolute amusement on the face of the chemist of "here's another kid that got sucked in," it was never true. There was always some myth that there were medicinal properties of the wings, and the chemist would sell them to a drug company and you'd get 5 cents per Black Prince. And I can tell you quite embarrassingly, that's not true.
Oh, that's a shame.
It was. Have you ever seen what I call a Union Jack, the double drummer?
Yeah, I've seen a number of double drummers. It's the largest species of cicada that we have here in Australia. But I haven't actually heard or seen any in the last couple of years, and I'd really like to know why that is. So hopefully I might have some answers.
Yeah, no, they were pretty rare when I was a kid. So there would always be lots of greengrocers, a few Black Princes, lots of yellow Mundies, I think we called them.
Yep.
But the Black Prince, as I said, it was the very rare. I only ever had one, and I preserved it in methylated spirits because it was so rare.
Oh, fantastic.
So the book that you've got, A Photo Guide to Common Cicadas of Greater Sydney, how many cicadas are in that book?
So there's 22 of the most common cicada species in the Sydney region, but some of those species have distributions which extend into or up into Queensland and down into Victoria as well. So we've got about 35 species that we know of in the Sydney region, so this is covering, I guess, the greater proportion of that.
And have you researched in your time looking into the cicadas that period, I think in the mid-80s, when a group of them ate Five Doc?
Oh, I have heard that song, yes. It's very, very interesting, to say the least.
It is. It's a good song. It's by Outline, and I think we'll play it now. Dr. Nathan Emery, have a great Wednesday.
Thank you.
There is Dr. Nathan Emery. The book is a photo guide to common cicadas of the greater Sydney region.